program runs from June of the student's junior year until June of their senior year. The positions could include gathering motorcycle data, data entry, and administrative duties. The students are evaluated mid-year and at the end of the year. To be considered for the co-op program, students from area high schools send a resume to Harley Davidson. School counselors submit the student's resume, which is reviewed at Harley Davidson, along with the student's grade point average and work experience. Al Luck is the intro to engineering design instructor at West High School. Project Lead the Way prepares students to be the most innovative and productive leaders in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Project Lead the Way is offered to students at East and West High School. This is the second year the program has been offered in Wauwatosa.
After the East High School Destination Imagination team captured the state title in April, they went on to the DI Global Tournament last month in Knoxville and took fifth place with their Breaking News Challenge. The competition featured 60 other structure teams from around the world. Members of East DI team are sophomores Aaron Zarnecki, Maggie Elliott, Casey Stokes, Elise Walker, and Lorenza DeVell, and freshman Sam Elliott. The team manager is Jim Elliott. DI is a multidisciplinary scholastic competition that combines aspects of engineering, set design, acting, and improvisation.
Congratulations to each of these individuals and to the DI team for their accomplishments. The next item on our agenda is the public hearing on the proposed budget. Mr. Mack initially presented the budget at our last meeting, and we'll review that presentation at this time. Mr. Mack? Yes, please.
I mean, what I'm going to do is just give a review, basically, of by the presentation that I gave 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago. If you have any questions during the presentation, feel free to ask. The tax levy change was the biggest impact in the budget this year. You know, through those factors, the general fund, right now I have going up about $4 million or 10%. Non-referendum debt, about $2,000 down, stays about the same every year. Capital expansion fund is where we do our buildings, refurbishment and capital maintenance projects. That's going up $80,000 or 5.71%, and a rec department going up $41,000 or about 5.8.2%. The total tax levy, I put question marks by that, about $4.2 million, 9.94%. I don't think it's going to be that high at 9.94, but until all of the spending is completed by all the districts in the state, it's really hard to know exactly. I do know that with regards to our position on counting children from the county, that we've had some success with being able to count about half of them, and that should bring our levy down about another $800,000 or about 2%. That's what I'm hoping for right now, so that 9.94 should be closer to 8%, everything else being the same. There's other factors, and I don't know what's going to happen with those yet, but that's what I would say right now. If I had a guess, 8%. The total tax levy, about $43.8 million, general fund, $281,000, non-referendum debt, capital expansion, $1.48 million, and the recreation department, $756,000. Total levy, $46,359,000, and last year was $42,168,000. These are the only ways that tax levy can move. And as you can see, the equalization aid is by far the biggest effect. When a state lowers the aid, the levy goes up. It's just an automatic offset. So if the state is not funding at the 67% level, which they said they were, and it has kept, it has creeped down over the years. That means the tax levy will go up. Chapter 228 decreased to 428,000. We have less kids in that program, so our aid continues to go down. However, I will point out the offset to that is we have taken in more open enrollment students, and the way the open enrollment revenue works through the equalization aid formula actually helps us get more equalization aid and actually pulls us out of negative tertiary aid. So there's some complicated factors in there, but there's an offset to that Chapter 228 aid decrease. The revenue cap increase, this is where our spending can actually increase in the formula. That $200 per member was about 200 and probably would have been near 270, 75 this year, and it was decreased to $200 per member simply because the aid that the state allocated could not afford any more than that, even with the levy going up at that point. If they would have had 275, that levy effect would have been even greater than the 10%. It would probably have been another, at least 1% on there. The computer aid increase or decrease, that's in the formula just for taxes on computer equipment that's located in Wauwatosa. It doesn't normally have a big effect on the levy. And it's a slight decrease, 0.11%. And the recreation department increase going up 41,000 has a slight increase in the levy going up of 0.1%. So the total there you see is just under 4.2 million or right around 10%. If you look at the property tax and state resources, when the lines go apart, the tax levy is going to go up more. And you can see in 11 there that the lines split across, the lines are going apart even farther than they were the year before. And that's been the pattern for about the past 3 years here. They've been moving farther apart, and as they do so, that means the state is giving less aid, and what they are doing is they are forcing in local governments to raise their taxes. The equalized value tax rate, and this assumes the equalized value, I put it in as zero right now. It might be negative, it might stay good, but my opinion is it's going to stay close to zero anyway. The tax rate is really something just used by schools to compare school to school. It doesn't really apply because this is where we had questions on a tax bill, that this is not the rate on the assessed value. This is equalized value. The equalized value is set by the state. The assessed value is set by the city assessor. So this rate doesn't go and apply to when you use your tax bill. Dollar for dollar. I'm going to work with the city for the October budget to try to get a somewhat accurate position of what the tax rate and the percentage increase will be on the tax bill. But you can see that because I didn't change equalized value, that it's going to be about the same 9.94%. And on an average, I don't know what the average home is, but I took a $250,000 home, and the increase for 2011 is about $196. And there's a huge number, so there's some rounding in there, but that's what the 10% would increase would equate to. Now, if it was 8%, it's going to be closer to $150 in there. And I don't know what it's going to be yet. I mean, it's all dependent on what all the other school districts spend in the state. The total budget expenditures for 10-11, the net general fund, $67.8 million. The special ed fund, $12.7 million. Non-referendum debt, $285,000. And the capital expansion fund, $1.48 million. That's $82,278,000, and that is under the revenue cap. Not under the revenue cap, we have the rec department at $1.5 million, the food service fund, $2.5 just under 2.2 million in donation fund is 90.5. And the reason I show those separately is food fund is self-supporting. The donation fund is simply for donations, and the rec department has its own levy that is not part of the revenue caps. The total tax levy without the rec department, 45,602,949, increase of about 4.15 million or 10%. With the rec department, it's 46,359,820, increase 4.2 million or 9.94%. Now, this doesn't include the prior year uncollected levy, which will add about a quarter of a percent to the total levy. And I went over that in the last meeting, and that's simply because the city had numerous adjustments with properties that were, I don't want to get into it, but one property, for example, was sold, it was Brownies and sold to the Milwaukee Metropolitan Sewer District, and it was classified as taxable property, and it really was tax exempt. That was one of the examples. And there were a couple more items of that nature. So what the city does is they rebill all the taxing authorities within their jurisdiction, and we have to pay for that. So basically, you're going to get taxed for what you were already taxed for in a previous tax levy. I wanted to go over this again one more time simply because it is important just to understand that the state funding for K-12 education, if you look at the last two numbers on that first green line, that is the amount the state is appropriating for equalization aid. And that's in millions, so that's billions of dollars. It's about $4.67 billion. And you can see that the dollar amount stayed the same from last year and for the 10-11 school year, which means that if school spending goes up and the aid stays the same, the levy is going to go up more for everyone. The bottom lines, I got those split on a different graph here. I'm going to go through those a little bit more. I just want to show you these because the scale is so far apart on all the aids that the state allocates. If you can see here, if you go back to 05-06 to 10-11, the general equalization aid pool is only going up 1.2%. It's only gone up 1%. Hardly, not even close to what school spending has gone up. And part of that is the recession. Part of it is the tax receipts that the state has taken in. I don't know the whole story, what goes on, all the budget, but I do know that it's gone down, and that is what is forcing up the tax levy, not only here, but pretty much everywhere throughout the state. This is a critical line to look at, this graph right here. You're seeing the categorical aid, which is the red line. That's basically for EEN aid and for other categorical aid, like your children's hospital. But take a look at the blue line, the school property tax credit. That money was supposed to be going into, at least my understanding was, that's why we have an equalization aid formula on a state level, is to equally distribute the money so that the state has an effort to equalize the spending between property-rich districts and what they would call property-poorer districts, so that the poor districts would get a larger portion of the aid so they could equalize the tax levy burden on all of the people in all of the districts. But if you look at that graph, from 05 to 06 to 10-11, that has gone up 91.1%. So here we have on those lines, the general school aid going up 1%, and school property tax credits going up 91.1%. And that has really disrupted what was supposed to be the state's primary way of funding schools, which was the state equalization aid formula. And we're losing almost $2.5 million in that because they shifted the money to the school property tax credit from the general school aid. And that, sorry, you could see that paper right up on the internet on the Legislative Fiscal Bureau Budget Report of August 2009. It's an annual loss. This has gotten bigger, and you can see that line going up. And I put these in here to make a point, really, because I wanted people to see where the money was going and where it was coming from. And these are the winners. These are the winners of that shift of where you saw that blue line going up. Elmbrook got an additional $12 million annually from that shift. Madison got it almost $9 million. Mequon-Thiensville, $7.5 million. Nicolet Union High School, which is just a high school, mind you, $3 million. Lake Geneva, which is just a high school, $2.5 million. Arrowhead, which is just a high school, $2.1 million. Tewaukee got $2.1 million. Glendale, we're over here at Fox Point, New Berlin. Almost all of those school districts are doing major building projects too. And I guess if you look at the top one, you can kind of see why they did pass that building proposal in Elmbrook, simply because, I don't know how this all happened. How this happened is beyond my comprehension. But you can see that the winners are very wealthy communities in this. Here's the losers. And I put area, except I put Appleton and Oshkosh in there too. Milwaukee's losing $12 million. Racine, $6 million. Waukesha, $3 million. Kenosha, $2.8 million. West Bend, almost $2.8 million. Wauwatosa, we're one of the big losers. In fact, we're one of the biggest losers on a percentage basis. We're second biggest loser on a percentage basis. $2.5 million. Appleton's losing $2.4 million. Oshkosh, $2.2 million. And you can see the rest of the numbers there. Those losses are going through that last screen to the other people's gain. And it's going outside of the equalization aid formula. They're putting it on your tax bill. You see that little school tax levy credit? Well, what you're doing is you're skirting the formula and putting it up there in that other box. And then here's some other winners. It's just really interesting because you saw all the property-rich districts, the very rich, high-spending districts getting the money, taking it basically from districts who are spending less per member. And then the other big winners in this shift of funding were basically lake districts up north, people that have land that are a lot of land that is cottages and so forth on lakes. And the funny thing about this is what I don't really understand when I really start thinking about this. A lot of this property is owned for people or by people who don't even live in Wisconsin. So we're giving tax money to tax breaks to people that don't even live in Wisconsin by this whole tax shift. I struggle with this a lot because I don't understand this piece of it, and it does affect us. It's 6% on our levy, that $2.5 million. How did this happen? Why did this happen? I asked people, no answer from anybody. No one knows how this happened or why this happened. I don't know if this happened behind closed doors to make the final budget deal go through, but I have no idea. No one could answer me. I asked the Association of Equity Funding, the people that put this together, they don't know. I've asked some other business managers, they don't know. Obviously, the people that gained aren't going to say anything. The people that lost are just kind of finding this out, how big of an impact it had on them. But we really do need to organize and get this stopped and reversed. We need to just take it out and put it out how it was.
Just a comment on that. We are going to be reconvening the school board's legislative committee, and I think it's, I talked with Mr. Ray about that. We're going to begin setting up a meeting with our area legislators. I think it's critical that we do that because this needs to be reversed, and we need to push extremely hard to reverse that and get back into where the equalization aid formula is supposed to be. Again, this was something I think Mr. Mack pointed out. Nobody knows the answer. We haven't been able to get any answers as to how this happened and why it happened, and that's pretty concerning, especially when we're percentage-wise the second biggest loser in the state of Wisconsin when it comes to property, when it comes to this shift. So we're going to begin that and start setting up meetings in the near future with our legislators.
Take you back to this line here. When you look at when this line went to this line, and part of the reason I didn't even know this until I saw this too, but when you see this shift here, and it was about $70 million going from equalization aid to the property tax credit, that explains a lot of what you saw on the tax bill, because we don't see that school, but this, even though it says a school property tax credit, that's given directly to the municipality. That's not given to the school district. That's part of the issue here. So when you saw that bigger increase on the levy, that's really what caused it right there. You did this huge increase from there to there, shifting from equalization aid up to the property tax credit, and they took away from us. And that's why you saw such a big jump. There's going to be a slight difference between assessed value and equalized value, but it's usually never like we saw last year, and that explains it. Now, here you're seeing it's going to be relatively flat this year to this year, $7 million. So you shouldn't see a huge difference between the equalized value and assessed value unless the city's doing something with TIFs or something else new that's going to cause the tax levy to jump when they allocate, but I don't think they're doing that either. So this year it's relatively flat, but that slope of that line right there is a huge reason why you saw that the tax bill last year went, what you saw on a piece of paper given to you versus what I presented for the school district. Because we don't, even though this is counted as a school property tax credit, the school district does not receive the money. That money is received by the city. I think that's all I have. Do you have any questions? Remember that there's still a lot of unknowns at this point in time, a lot of unknowns, and that as we head into the summer and the fall, more and more variables become known, and I can give you an update when I learn something, but generally that isn't until in September, right before we set the levy anyway, because that's when the state starts to finalize all the expenditures from all the districts, and they know how much the spending increased for everybody throughout the state, where they set the parameters for the equalization aid. I'm hoping that we can mobilize forces and get that property tax credit back to the way it was. I really think that was the intent of the laws when they put them into play, and I have no idea why they did it or what was the purpose of that. But I think we need to work on changing that. So other than that, if you have any questions, that's where everything stands at the present time.
Dr. Early, do you have anything
further
to add at this point?
Not at this point.
Board members?
Mrs. Randall? John, could you give an overview of, you mentioned a couple times, we're waiting to find out what all the districts spent and the impact of spending that's on the equalization aid, correct? That affects the equalization aid.
The impact on the inventory.
The amount that all the different districts have spent, we're waiting to find that out.
How do we find out?
And what is that impact? What does that affect?
Well, the equalization aid you saw on the line there, that $4.6 billion, that's distributed based on the equalization formula. So everybody puts their budgets together in, and they have to have that budget report sometime in, November it is. But most business managers are conservative. They budget less. They budget over budgeting and over be conservative on expenditures. And you don't know what happens with the actual because it's budget versus actual. So until we know what everybody actually spent, how that $4.6 million gets divvied up, you don't know until all that spending comes together. Because if the spending was lower, then everybody's going to get a little bit more aid than projected. If the spending is higher, then everybody's going to get a little bit less aid than projected. And that's why. But the number is so big that it's going to be pretty close to what I said on.
And then is that number looked at as one lump sum, or then do the districts get their equalization aid based on whether they spend more or less? The individual districts, right.
That goes through the equalization aid formula. Mm-hmm. That's a very complicated formula, actually, that the spending goes through. They filter out some revenues, they add some revenues, and it gets whatever they come up with, that goes through the equalization aid formula, and then that $4.6 billion gets distributed to all the districts via the equalization aid formula. Now, that other money that was shifted from the equalization aid formula on that blue line, that should be in that pool, too. That's another $100 billion, $100 million. That would have been shifted. If that had been in that pool, our levy would be about 6% less, because we would have bought another $2.5 million through the equalization formula. And the reason is we actually spend below the state average when it comes to per pupil spending. And it gets complicated, but the reason we spend below the state average is because of our open enrollment revenue does not count. When they figure out the spending per member, they only do it for residents. They don't include non-residents. So all the money we get, which is about $7 million for open enrollment, that's excluded from calculating our cost per member. So we actually are much lower than probably 90% of the districts when it comes to spending per resident member.
Our actual increase in our budget, in our spending, is 1.2%
right
over last year.
That's the ironic thing. And when you see when I adjust the grants in October, we'll probably have a negative increase in our budget, and yet the tax levy is going to go up, which is because of the way the aid formulas work. And right now, the increase in the budget is about 1.2%.
Any other board member question or comment, Mr. Potter?
A couple of times you made the comment that the state is forcing the levy up, but that's only if we choose to spend the maximum allowed by law. Is that correct? And we choose to spend. I mean, we're not required to spend as much as we're spending, are we?
I'm not understanding.
The amount of money that's being transferred to the levy to reduce state aid, are we required to spend that amount?
Oh, are we required? No, we're not required to. I mean, you could lower the tax levy if you wanted to, but if you do that, you're going to permanently harm the school district, or you're going to have to make cuts to do that. I mean, I think I explained that pretty thoroughly in the last one. It's not taxed to the max, like the media has portrayed it to be. It's taxed to whatever the formula allows. And under the old method, the QEO was 3.8%, and your tax to the max is about 2.5%. I don't know how you can call it tax to the max if it doesn't even cover the minimum that you have to offer your bargaining unit. Somehow that got misconstrued everywhere. But we don't know. We don't have to do that. Well, you could take a position going into the future if you wanted to. You could lower the tax levy and just prepare for cuts. And we could make as many cuts as you wanted to lower the tax levy.
Mrs.
Campbell?
So just to clarify something. So say we decide we're not going to make as many investments this year. Say $500,000. Does it change the tax levy?
If we reduce the budget $500,000?
Yeah, we say we can't invest in some things. We're going to not invest $500,000.
I think the impact is going to be so tiny. I mean, what you're saying is $500,000 on $82 million. You're talking about reducing expenditures, correct?
Right. We're not going to spend as much. So we're not going to do some investments that we're planning to do. We can't buy as many books as we wanted to. We can't replace as many computers as we wanted to. We can't fill as many open positions as we wanted to, et cetera. What would happen with the tax levy?
Well, we could lower it. I mean, we could actually you don't have to go up that $1.2 million that the tax levy is allowed under the revenue cap. We don't have to do that. But that $200 per member in the long run is not going to cover the teacher contract. It's just not, based on what settlements have been coming in. We have to have 0% increases in contracts and probably have people pay more health insurance premiums and contributions. That would be just to stay level, just to stay level, because 85% of our budget is salaries and benefits. So $500,000 over $80 million, while it is something, I'm not saying it's nothing, but it's tiny. If you want to have a dent on something, you say cut $5 million and really do something, then if you really wanted to do something and have 40 kids in a class or however you want to do it, get rid of half of the administration, I don't know, that's the only place you could do it, but you'd have a school district that would look very different than it does now. I don't know if I answered that right or not.
And that's what I'm getting at. I mean, there are some things that we can control, and there are some things that we don't control. We do have to think about those things we control. But is the impact enough to keep us even with the increase we gave the taxpayers last year? That would be my question to you. What would we have to do to keep our increase even with last year?
Well, we saw right now our levy is going up about $4 million. That's a lot. Mm-hmm. I mean, and on the other hand, if you look at making reductions of $4 million, that's a lot of reductions to make, a lot. Because if you figure, you need to figure $70,000, and I can't figure it out right in the top of my head, but you're talking probably 50, 60 positions that would have to go to keep this thing level. And I don't think you're going to get that all from non-teaching staff. You're just not. I mean, if you look at other districts around the state, they're cutting quite a few teachers. You know, we've been so far very, very fortunate not to have to do that. Very fortunate. And but doing a $500,000 thing, which I'm not saying it's not a lot, but when you're talking $80 million, it really isn't a big dent, per se, to lower taxes. Or you want to just cut the budget by $500,000, I mean, we could have any goal going into a year to do something like that, to say, let's reduce $500,000 or let's reduce a certain amount. But on the other hand, we did agree to a new teacher contract, which gave them a substantial increase. And I don't want to say this in a negative way, but our buildings are older, and we're increasing the amount we have to put into the buildings every year just to maintain them. And we're not in a position here where we're able to build new buildings even, or even make major remodels because of the way the aid formula works. So, I mean, we just saw in there, we've gone from about $1.2 million to about $1.5 million just to keep the buildings
operating in a manner that's sufficient so that people don't complain about the school.
Oh, and I understand that. I totally understand. I'm just trying to bring some more clarity to how this process works. So the vote tonight is basically going to be on 9.94%. You're estimating that when all the numbers are in and said and done, that will probably be at an 8% increase.
That's what I think right now. I'm hoping that'll even be lower than that, but I don't want to say that because I don't know what the spending is going to be throughout the rest of the state, and that's why I can't really make a more definitive, you know. But based on what we have for membership adjustments at the county, we are going to get about $800,000 more in aid. That's what I'm roughly figuring, which will bring that tax rate to about 8%. Now remember, if you look around at other school districts, I remember looking at, I thought Kettle Moraine was close to 7%, and they're fairly close to the size and structure of us, and they don't have that county program interference right now. So all things being equal, our tax levy probably still would have gone up 6-7% even without the county program that we've had to deal with, and Kettle Moraine didn't have to deal with losing $2.5 million in this property tax switch, you know, from the levy credit. They actually gained about $400,000 on that. So it's high, but it's going to be high. It's going to be high everywhere. It's not just here. It's everywhere because the spending has gone up and the aid is staying the same. So if one level of funding stays the same, the other has to go up to compensate for it. And that's what's happening throughout the entire state of Wisconsin.
I know the board was committed to investing in our employees, and that's what we did, and that's what the community wanted us to do. We needed to do that. But what you're basically saying to me is that, this is what I'm thinking, is that we could go down 2 points on the increase just by the aid formulas. If we were to go down by 2 points on our expenses, it's not really going to have much of an impact, and the only real impact we can have is to really reorganize our school district.
Yeah, you can look at it that way. That's one way. I mean, there's a lot of different ways you could approach this. But the problem, the one problem with all of that, and you can restructure and you can cut and everything, but the way I see it, it's going to keep happening. I don't see anything stopping what's going on out there right now. We need a fundamental change in the way things are financed so that the property taxpayers do not have to bear such a big burden. And that's why in the last presentation, I know some people might be against it, and there's a lot of people said we're not going to do it, but most states around the country have done it already, and that's adding a penalty on the property, on a sales tax to finance the school. And in Wisconsin, they need to start drawing some direct lines for school financing that if you put a penny on the sales tax, it's going to the schools. There's no shifting that, and it's going to keep property taxes in check, or property taxes can only go up a certain amount with that amount. That's the only way I see things changing, is they have to draw a line. Even with the old system, I'm not going to go on with this, but they had that what they call the three-legged stool, the QBO, the revenue caps, and the equalization aid. The big problem with that is there were no hard lines connecting those three. They need a system in place in Madison. It needs to affect not just school districts, but all levels of government, the state government, the city government, county government, everybody. And what they need is a system if they're going to do something where if you do have a revenue limit, that the amount you can give for increase to employees is directly connected to that, and that the amount that you're funding it and your revenue that's supporting with it is directly connected to that hard, like a hard, fast connection, so that there is no, we can't afford it this year, sorry, but your taxes are going up, and then local school boards face the brunt of all the accusations that you're not, you know, knowing what you're doing, or this or that, or that, you know, you're not restricting your spending, kind of a thing, which is, it's just not true. It just, what the laws that were set in place did not have adequate controls on making the system in its entirety work together, and that's the problem. And it's been a problem, and it's been very frustrating, because we go through this every year. And that's why I say, you could say, okay, let's cut this out, and the next year, what are you going to do? The same thing? And then the same thing the year after, and the same thing the year after. We've been very, very fortunate in the fact that we've been able to take open enrollment kids and avoid what a lot of school districts are doing. So.
Well, and I would have to also argue and point out to you that we have been reorganizing behind the scenes. I mean, I know that you and Dr. Bertle and all the directors and all the principals are really looking thoroughly and making sure kids have what they need. And you haven't had to come to us with a huge cut list in the 5 years that I've been serving. Thank you for that. But unless, what you're telling me is, unless something drastically changes, or we decide to drastically change something, our school district, since we've already been reorganizing, but we're still investing, we're not short-term borrowing, we need to ask the taxpayers for some extra increase, is really what you're saying.
I would still say this school district, compared to any other school district in the whole state, I know the taxes are going up, but as far as financial position, if you were running your household, this is the way you would run it. This is the way you would run it, because we don't short-term borrow. And we do everything, as, in my opinion, as fiscally conservative as possible, without borrowing and without spending our fund balance, our savings that you're supposed to have. So, you set a, you know, that what really bothers me about that that shift in a property tax credit is that you set a course, and if you're the captain of an ocean liner, you're going down a course, and all of a sudden the state puts a Y in the water, and you can't change, you're going down this course. You can't change the boat's position, and then all of a sudden the money's going this way. And that's what I think irritated a lot of people with that property tax levy credit, that you can't just all of a sudden change a giant ship and say, okay, let's adjust for two different things that are going different directions. You can't do that. It's impossible. And that's the frustrating thing. But overall, given what we've done over the number of years that all of these formulas have been in place, I think that the school board has done an excellent job here of maintaining fiscal integrity and hopefully providing the best quality of education in the most fiscal responsible way for the taxpayers. And I know taxes have to go up, but there's not a lot of control that we have, unfortunately, because of the way the state formulas are.
The board members? Mr. Gray?
Mr. Mack, there is my understanding of the state funding formulas is that the state sets the level of revenue that individual school districts can raise in order to operate. And then individual school districts also have the option of going to referendum and through a referendum request asking the citizens of that community to allow them to spend even more than what the state would allow them to spend through the funding formulas. Is that generally correct?
That's absolutely correct. And we, if you want to spend more, than what's allocated in that revenue cap increase of $200, you can put a referendum and say, we want to spend an extra $4 million per year and increase taxes another 8% or 10%, and you would have no fiscal problem. Now, the problem with doing something like that in Wauwatosa has always been in that equalization aid formula. If we increase our spending dramatically, we get penalized for that because there's three tiers of funding, and in that third level, we get negative aid, which for every dollar we spend, we lose about, now it's about 55 or 60 cents on a dollar. So for every dollar we would go to referendum, it costs the taxpayers $1.60, which is just not prudent finance. But the ironic part is those districts you saw up on the board that were winners, they lost all of their, all, right off the bat, they lost all of their, what do you want to call it, secondary and tertiary aid, they're the primary aid districts, so when they go to a referendum, it's dollar for dollar. They don't have to worry about losing anything. They're extremely high property per member districts. So when they got that extra money, that's the other thing, they got the extra money, they were able to issue bonds to go over the revenue limit, and they felt no impact because they got the taxes through a different mechanism than equalization aid formula. But that's been always the Achilles heel for Wauwatosa, that we're that high negative aid district, and we can't. So we've always lived within whatever that revenue cap has been.
Well, my next question was going to be, in building this year's budget, you're not proposing that we go to referendum in order to do that, correct?
No.
All right. You're working with budget numbers that are allowable numbers set by the normal state formula for us to raise as a school district.
Yep. That's what I've done always, and that's how this year's budget would go, too.
And you said that the approximate increase, if we just look at the budget numbers, compared last year's budget to this year's budget, the approximate increase for the budget is 1.2%.
That's correct.
And given what's been happening with shifting of how the state is funding school districts, and our school district in particular, even though our budget increase is 1.2%, the potential ramification is an approximate 10% increase on the tax level.
That is absolutely correct.
And if we set a goal of wanting to keep the tax levy flat, we would then have to actually decrease our budget by approximately what, 5%?
$4 million, whatever the tax levy is going up.
Okay. So in an $8.6 million or $86 million budget, rough numbers.
Almost 3.5% approximately.
Okay. And in doing so, we would experience the loss of the staff positions that you alluded to earlier.
Right. You'd have to, well, just roughly, I mean, 60 positions, that 70,000 is 4.2 million. So look at 60 positions. 60 positions, a lot of positions in a district this size.
And as Dr. Ertl alluded to a little bit ago, it seems like it would definitely be a prudent step for us to make sure that we're continuing to be active in talking with our legislative people so that, number one, they're crystal clear on what the impact is for us, and number two, we can hopefully work with them to try to impact some change to shift the stream back to where it was, at the very least, in terms of how they're allocating dollars. And I can't remember if you said this or Dr. Ertl said this, but on a percentage basis statewide, where do we fall in terms of winners and losers with respect to the way that the state has shifted dollars from the equalization aid to the school tax levy?
We were the second biggest loser on that blue line. The percent of the aid to the credit was a loss of 9.3%. There was only one district, and that was East Troy Community
D district that lost 10.8%, I believe. So we were, percentage-wise, second. We lost second in that funding switch. And again, like I said, what gets me with all that is I don't know how that happens. I just am amazed that they have a mechanism all set up to distribute the aid, and then they just make a shift like that. And I can't even fathom how they vote for that and how it gets through.
And another thing that is ironic to me, and I don't know if you recall this, but last year in June, when the state budget process was working its way through, we would get alerts as to what was happening and what might have a negative impact on our district. And there were people in the district that were communicating with our legislative people to try to address those alerts and try to have a positive impact with respect to how our district and our community would be impacted. And I don't recall this particular issue, this shifting of funding, being an alert that came to anyone's attention during that budgeting process last year.
No, and it was more like, don't say anything about this. You know, I don't remember anybody saying anything about this happening whatsoever.
Anything further, Mr. Ray? Mr. Meyer?
I'd just like to extend Mr. Ray's comments, if it's okay, Mr. Ray. If we hold the levy flat this year and lay off 50 to 60 people, we're facing the same decision still next year, which is Mr. Mack's point that this is like trying to stop a flood. You better learn how to cope with water, because you're not going to, you might stop it for a while, but it's going to happen. So we'd be back looking at 50 or 60 layoffs next year again to continue on this path, and we cripple our school district. We'd probably disrupt most of our educational programs, and we'd have people telling us that we weren't properly educating our kids because of test scores would start to fall. And I won't vote to do that.
Mr. Connor?
I have a couple comments on some of the other comments that were made. And it seems to me that in discussing the budget, it was presented as an either-or. Either we don't cut the budget, or we cut $4 million. And we don't lay off teachers, or we have to lay off 60 teachers. There is an in-between. And I think it's unfair to portray that if we cut anything, we have to cut $4 million. The other thing is that reducing the tax levy from 10% to 8%, or dropping maybe $500,000 to $800,000, was called insignificant. But yet, I have the feeling from some comments that board members are going to vote for the budget because it's 10% now, but it might go to 8% in the fall if the state funding changes. So I'm a little unclear why if we cut 2% raise from the tax levy, it's insignificant, but if the state does it, it's significant. So I'm a little confused by that. My last comment is on the teacher contract. We did sign a new teacher's contract, and I think the teachers did deserve a raise. But I'm going to point out that, again, if we were to make cuts, we aren't automatically required to cut 50 or 60 teachers. That's not the choice before. So we could fit somewhere in between there, I think. And I'm going to point out that, we signed a contract with individual teachers. We didn't sign a contract that said we must employ every teacher in the district for so many years. So if we can find a way to deliver education in a better way, a more efficient way, maybe even one that increases student learning with fewer teachers, we have an obligation to look at that. And just because we're doing it one way now doesn't make it the perfect way or the best way for the future. And I'm not criticizing what we're doing now, but I think we constantly have to look at how can we do things better in a more efficient manner. We have two roles as I see it. One is to the students in the district to give them the best education possible, but we also have a duty to the taxpayers to do that in the most efficient way possible. So I would be comfortable, I'm not comfortable with the 10% increase. I'd like to see something at least 8% come out of the board tonight. I don't know that we'll see that. And if the state comes through with some extra money, then it will be even lower in the future. If there's an annual increase for property of $196, for some people that's a significant amount. I read statistics where the number of students that are eligible for reduced or free lunches went up 4 or 5% this year. So for families that are living from week to week or month to month, you know, dropping that $196 increase to $100 or $110 gives them an extra $100 to spend on food, clothes, and whatever. So from that perspective, it's not insignificant. So as we talk about the budget and the board possibly modifying the budget, I'd like them to keep in mind that there are ways to modify the budget to make some incremental improvements that will benefit the taxpayers without going all the way to a $4 million decrease for 50 to 60 teacher layoff. So please keep in mind that there are other approaches, that it's not just an either or approach.
Mrs. Randall?
I'm kind of troubled by the disconnect in the discussion tonight, because we're only talking about money. And it's like we all are here surprised. And in fact, throughout the year, as we have approved or not approved or discussed or voted on different initiatives, we have been given a budget impact. And as Mr. Ray pointed out, that those have all been fashioned within our allotted budget. You don't know today, you won't know probably until October how much money we're getting from the state. Our business here is to educate kids. Our business is to be the best district we can be and to generate more students coming in here. We work on this budget all year long. Just because we don't come to every meeting and say we're going to cut or are we going to cut, that's not the approach that we're taking in this district. Public education is funded by tax dollars. That's the bottom line. We have a huge responsibility to make sure that spending is done appropriately, responsibly, and we do that. But to have a discussion for an hour simply on dollar amounts is not what we've been doing. And hopefully it won't be what we've been doing. And if you look at the other districts who have cut personnel, closed schools, whatever, are they thriving now? No. It has not made a difference. You can go and look. You can look at Waukesha. Waukesha's nearing bankruptcy. They've closed schools. They let people go. Sussex Hamilton, there was an article about their short-term borrowing. We don't do those things here, but we do provide excellent education. And in the last few years, we have made significant commitments in our technology, our learning resources, and in our teachers. And also, I think what needs to be pointed out is that along with that contract settlement, we also gained a huge amount in our post-retirement benefits as part of that bargain, a significant savings down the road. Is that correct? So I guess I'm just having a lot of difficulty with this being kind of a surprise or anybody here feeling as though they haven't been involved in this process up till now. So, Mr. Ray?
Just a clarification question. Mr. Mack, you talked about right now the projected tax levy increase of approximately 10% with the hope that that's going to go down to somewhere in the neighborhood of 8%. A difference of 2%. I want to make sure I understand where that differential of 2% is potentially coming from. My understanding is that that is connected to what's going to happen with what funding we do or don't receive with respect to the county programs. Is that correct?
That's correct, because what we had a situation was they were not going to let those kids who reside at, say, the detention center, they were not going to let them count them anymore, let us count them as residents of Wauwatosa, even though they're living, quote, in Wauwatosa at the time. But we've come to an agreement with them that under certain conditions, we are able to count them as long as they're not counted by another school district. So Every student that we're able to count significantly impacts the amount of aid that we get. We're talking about right now, I think I average 55 added back to the count. and that's worth about $800,000. And that's why I would say it would go down about 2%. And hopefully that number will go up. We're still doing some checking on the January account from this previous year.
And I think it's important to point out that's another example of the state doing something different. And in this case, they did something different without any laws, without changing any of the language and any of the laws that are on the books. They just decided to change how they would provide funding with respect to that program. And when they did that, instead of our district doing nothing and just saying, okay, if that's the way you want to do it, we'll let you do it, we decided to take legal action against the DPI. And so part of the reason that we're talking about this 2% hopefully coming back to us is because we were determinative enough to say to the DPI, what you're doing, we disagree with, and we're willing to take some legal action to try to protect our financial position and your funding obligation with respect to us. And so part of the reason that if we are ultimately able to realize that change is because of persistence on the part of the district as a whole in terms of addressing that issue. Is that correct?
That's absolutely correct.
If there is anyone present who would like to make a comment on the budget presentation, please approach the microphone and again state your name, your address, and please try to limit your comments to 3 minutes. All right, seeing none, we'll move on to our action items. Mr. Meyer?
It is recommended that the school board approve the attached proposed 2010-11 budget. Fund expenditures are summarized as follows. General Fund 10, $73,612,292. Donation Fund 21, $90,500. Special Education Fund 27, $12,695,741. Non-referendum Debt Service Fund 38, $284,885. Capital Expansion Fund 41, $1,480,000. Food Services Fund 50, $2,183,181. Recreation Fund 80, $1,540,171. Total expenditures for all funds, $91,886,770, less interfund operating transfer from Fund 10 of $5,794,380, giving net total expenditures for all funds, $86,092,390. The 2010-11 budget will be adjusted in October after final enrollment. State aid and state revenue tax figures are available. The tax levy will be set at that time. Item 2, rooftop leases. It is recommended that the school board approve the rooftop leases with option between the district and Clear Wireless LLCC for placement of antenna facilities and utilities at McKinley, Washington, Wilson, and East as presented and discussed at the May 24 meeting. Clear Wireless will pay a $1,000 12-month option fee for each lease. If exercised, each lease option will add approximately $20,000 of revenue for the district, and I so move.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mrs. Weber?
Yes.
May we take
item 1 and 2 separately on the
vote?
Yes.
Is there any further discussion of either of the motions on the table? Is there any community comment on the 2 business services items before the board?
Business.
Specifically the budget and the rooftop leases. Seeing none, Mrs. Gaughan, do you call the roll on item 1?
Mr. Cronin?
No.
Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Mrs. Neufeld?
No.
Mrs. Randall?
Yes.
Mr. Ray?
Yes.
Mrs. Weber?
Yes.
Mrs. C?
Yes. Item 2.
Mr. Carter?
Yes.
Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Mrs. Milfeld?
Yes.
Mrs. Randall?
Yes.
Mr. Ray?
Yes.
Mrs. Weber?
Yes.
Mrs. Haynes?
Yes. Following the vote, item one and two have both passed. That brings us to the action item on human resources. Mrs. Weber?
It is recommended that the school board approve the job description of the athletic police director for Wauwatosa High School as presented and discussed at the May 24th meeting and the managing director at Wauwatosa West High School. Thank you.
Is there any objection to adding the word Wauwatosa to the motion? No, we'll do so by unanimous consent. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Connor. Is there any discussion on this item, board members? Is there any community comment on the human resources item? Seeing none, Mrs. Galante, would you call the roll?
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Mrs. Milfeld?
Yes.
Mrs. Randall?
Yes.
Mr. Ray?
Yes.
Mrs. Weber?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. The next item is student services. Mrs. Newcomb?
It is recommended that the school board approve the autism consultant agreement obtained through CESA number one for the 2010-11 school year, subject to provisions of section 66.0301 of Wisconsin statutes for 40 service hours at a cost of $3,285. And I so move.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Ray. Is there any discussion, board members, on this item? Mrs. Weber?
Can someone please tell me what the services will be that they are going to be giving us, please?
Mrs. Kwiatkowski?
Thank you. CESA 1 has employed an autism consultant to work with the districts in our region. Typically, what CESA 1 does is they allow districts to establish a one-day contract, and it costs about $1,200 a day to get the services of a consultant. What we're doing instead is I've partnered with some of the Wauwatosa districts so that we can establish 6630. The consulting services that we'll get will be tailored based on the needs of the students in our program. So Jen Townsend is an autism consultant. She has a lot in the area of autism. There's many specific research-based certifications and trainings that an individual can have, and Jen Townsend, their consultant, has many of them. So what she'll be able to do currently, we used her this past year for a different reason. One of the things that she was able to do with us is look at how one of our intensive services classrooms is arranged and give us some feedback in regard to the actual kids that are in that classroom, how we can adjust it and provide better services for those students. So some real direct consulting based on the students in our program, as well as just that opportunity with autism. Again, it's very unique, low incident, but high need. That opportunity to collaborate with some other districts around issues related to autism. So some professional development for our staff, as well as some direct services for our kids.
If there are individual needs identified, can she address those and give us direction?
I'm really confident in Jen and her, based on her training and skill. I became familiar with Jen about 2 years ago, just through a professional network, and she's extremely knowledgeable, and she's been, she also, this past year, established an opportunity for districts that have autism consultants. We're a fortunate district where we do have an autism consultant on staff who does the diagnostics for children with autism, as well as some program support for children with autism and are cognitively disabled persons. But when you work alone on that population, it's, again, a very complex group of kids, and each child looks differently. To have that opportunity to collaborate is critical. So Jen is kind of that. She's put together a consortium, a networking group of people from area districts to come in and troubleshoot, talk about the kids that they're working with, get access to some training and some research around those issues. So she's a really talented individual. I'm pretty excited that she's in our area. She just moved back to our area about a little over a year ago.
If there are individual concerns, she will take time to address those individuals, because all the material that I read on autism, and there's never enough once a month. But there are unique.
Mm-hmm.
And quite often you cannot There's no grouping. We need to look at each one individually. And she will give us that service?
Sure. If that's something that we feel we need, she's certainly there available. She's a great researcher with many trainings and certifications to get her the experience to do that and knowledge.
Are parents in any way involved that they become given some assurance, some direction if they have questions?
I do on a regular basis have network meetings for parents of students with disabilities, and I do plan on asking Jen to do a presentation at one of those meetings next year for parents of students with significant disabilities.
And if there are community members that are interested, does she do any outside, for instance, evening presentation that we all need to learn more?
Sure. Typically when I have my parent meetings, I have some during the day and some in the evening, and I always make it available. You know, we do our best. Chris Price was really helpful with getting the word out. So it's not just, a lot of times the topics are not just specific for parents of students with disabilities. They're just topics of interest. We've had some topics including mental health, AODA issues. So Jen would be one that I would open up to anybody. Often we'll have teachers that like to attend them as well. So it's a great opportunity to go and dialogue with somebody that has some expertise. So I see Jen as being a great resource for that.
So it's not just the teachers, perhaps, that are serving those children. It could be other teachers within the district.
I've actually had some general education teachers come as well, and I could see Jen being an interesting topic for a general education teacher who often, as a general education teacher, you may not have ever have a student with autism, but when you get that one, you need to know and you want to learn. Mm-hmm. So she certainly, if that would happen, obviously would have Jen directly available to that teacher. But just for teachers wanting their own knowledge, you know, wanting to build their own knowledge about the children with autism in their buildings, I'm sure that many would attend.
So this is a one-year contract,
mm-hmm.
and she very likely would be here more than one time.
Yes.
Can I say you when needed, or is there some program set up?
What we're going to do, actually, I just got an email from her today. Once the contract is approved by the board, I'm going to give her some timelines and some ideas. Again, it's a consortium. It's a 6630, so there's other districts involved in it. So she believes that she can provide some services that will be meaningful to all of us to kind of save our hours and use them for what we need for, because we're purchasing a set amount of hours from her.
Just so those hours are delivering what we need for most of us.
I believe they will be.
And I hope that we can have a report back on
sure.
this after the year.
Sure, I'd be happy to do that.
Thank you.
Any other board member question or comment? Is there any community comment on this action item? Seeing none, Mrs. Galante, will you call the roll?
Mr. Cronin?
Yes.
Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Mrs. Nofeld?
Yes.
Mrs. Randall?
Yes.
Mr. Ray?
Yes.
Mrs. Weber?
Yes.
Mrs. C?
Yes. That brings us to the superintendent's action item. Mr. Ray?
It is recommended that the school board approve the 2010-11 through 2012-13 Information and Technology Literacy Plan as presented and discussed at the May 24th meeting, and I so move.
Is there a second? Thank you, Mrs. Weber. Is there any board comment or discussion?
If I can just make a comment, I think it's important when you look at a technology literacy plan that it's a plan. So when the board approves the plan, it's not approving all the spending, that very clearly we come back with any purchases throughout the time of the plan for making recommendations. And I think another piece that's important to point out is we move beyond the recent changes to the infrastructure. The focus of what we're trying to work on with technology right now is clearly the student learning aspect of it, and taking what we have in the new infrastructure and the technology to really impact what's happening in the classroom and ultimately impact learning for students. We certainly don't want to be a district, and we're not a district of just having a lot of nice technology sitting around. And I think we have some people that, like Mr. Price and Senator Berger, focusing on that aspect of technology, and that's where this plan is going to guide us. And I think it's important to point that out as we move in that direction. Now that those things are in place.
Mrs. Weber?
Not only that we're kept informed with the vote on the costs that we would be needing to approve, I would just ask that we keep informed on what changes, additions are made so that we have first-hand information how we are improving, how we are serving each one of the children in our classrooms.
Mr. Cronin? Carter?
First, I want to say I thought this was a very, very well-written report. I mean, it's very informative and it's very clear what direction we're moving in. I just have one question, because training the teachers is an important part of the report, and I'm curious about the target that was selected for teachers to meet, that they should be at or above 8th grade student proficiency levels. Am I understanding that correctly, or why was that target picked for teacher proficiency?
Could you give me a page reference?
Page 28, 4.1, educator proficiency.
That it's ongoing?
No, 4.1.1, I said.
Okay, what is the question about the timeline?
No, the target for the faculty proficiency levels.
Oh,
why,
yeah.
Why do you select an 8th grade for the faculty?
Because 8th grade is actually one of the requirements for testing from BDI to make sort of like a midway assessment. There's assessments at 4th, 8th, and 12th grades. The ones at 4th and 12th are more observational in nature. The one at 8th grade is more of a survey, of like a formalized assessment. And the reason that it's conducted in that manner is for the transition into high school, where there will be more or higher levels of technology literacy expectations. Why did we choose that? Because that is the general benchmark of where we want our students to at least be, and we can't expect them to inherently adopt the use of information and technology as an educative tool unless we lead and mentor them in that manner as well. Does that answer the question?
Yes, thank you.
Anything further, board members? Is there any community comment on this agenda item? Seeing none, Mrs. Galante, would you call the roll?
Mr. Crowder?
Yes.
Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Mrs. Wheelfeld?
Yes.
Mrs. Bradlow?
Yes.
Mr. Ray?
Yes.
Mrs. Weber?
Yes.
Mrs. Fee?
Yes. Thank you very much. That brings us to reports to the board, and we begin with student services and the Student Bill of Rights. Mr. Carter is here to present us this evening.
Thank you. It's a little easier if you're by myself. Well, thank you for giving us the opportunity to talk about the Student Bill of Rights that we've been working on this year. What we did, we took our task from the long-range plan, and it came from an idea to develop the Student Bill of Rights that was developed by the Long Range Plan Committee, and it came under the area of student conduct in safe, respectful, and ethical manner, and came from that descriptor that relates to school discipline, respect to each other and diversity. So what we did was we took our task of developing a Bill of Rights and Responsibilities that came from page 44 of the Student Bill of Rights. Our purpose as a committee was to develop a Student Bill of Rights that gave the students the opportunity to create expectations for the district, not for us to create expectations for them. We have a code of conduct. We wanted to figure out from them what they want from us in the education. And so that's what we asked the question, what do the students value or want in an educational experience? Our committee was made up of parents, and Mr. and Mrs. Glazer, who did an outstanding job of helping us get student input and feedback. They took time out of their work day to come in during the day and meet with us as a committee. We had two social workers, Emily O'Connor at the elementary level and Sonia Nelson, who represented the secondary level. And we also had Mrs. Wayne Scott, who was a community liaison of the Long Range Planning Coordinator, and then the administration one was me. I thought it would be good to go through the process that we went through briefly, just so you know how we got to the final draft that I gave you, the revised version. We started off by discussing what we wanted to do, making sure we had a vision and a spirit down of creating that bill, so that we didn't get confused with making more responsibilities or commitments on students, but actually getting information from them and as to what they wanted in a document. So what we did after that was we researched other Student Bill of Rights documents, looked at local, state, and national documents, And then we had direct conversation with other area school districts like Madison and Green Bay school districts who have pretty good student bill of rights documents and asked them how they went about it. Theirs seemed to be driven by adults. And so our charge was not to have the adults create it, which is a much safer way, but it was to get actually what the students want. Next, we looked at what population should we survey and get feedback from, and then how do we go about getting their feedback. After that, we solidified our discussion points for the student meetings, and then we looked at who would run those meetings at the various levels. There was a discussion of feedback from the student meetings. Once we got that information, we brought it back and all took a look at it. We also determined that we needed to go a little bit further than just those meetings with the students. We had them, students look at it in their mock school board meetings. We also had middle school U.S. history teachers teach a lesson on the student bill of rights, and then after that integrate the student bill of rights into that lesson and see what they came up with when they integrated into the curriculum. We also had Chris Kwiatkowski come and talk to us about how to integrate that, the information that we had, into the student services department and how that would look. After that, we organized students into the student input into three different branches. We had an elementary model, middle, and high school. And from there, we combined them into one document that represented elementary and a secondary school version. We then took the final draft to administrative council to get their input on it. And from there, Dr. Earl suggests we bring it to the school board for discussion. Anything? No? As far as student feedback, the community felt it was important to make sure we had a diverse population from within the Wauwatosa School District. So what we did was we went around and figured out where we could pull students strategically and get as much input as possible without disrupting the learning environment. And what we came up with, I'll show you a little bit later, but we also wanted to focus on 5th, 8th, and 12th because that seems to be, you know, that's the end of major educational settings for them. They're going to middle school, high school, and into college. And they could give us their overview of what their experiences were at those levels, elementary, middle, and high school. Elementary sampling was, we have fifth grade, and I should put fourth on there as well. We had Mrs. O'Connor, work with fourth and fifth graders at various elementary schools and put that information together in an elementary document. At the middle school, we used the student councils of both middle schools, and we had an eighth grade class at each middle school, Whitman and Longfellow. At the high school, they looked at student councils. We had special education students participate as well. We had best buddies participate, and we also had black student leaders participate in giving us feedback for a student bill of rights. And this is the document that we came up with. We started off with the Wauwatosa School District mission statement because that's our charge as a district, and we developed a preamble from there. Following that, we put all the documents together into one item. It did come out as 10 student bill of rights. We would have basically just creating three for the sake of creating three. And in our opinion, it was that the fewer, the better. That way it's easier to remember for the students, and it makes it a little more palatable for the elementary level kids. They can use it and refer back to it. So our preamble was, the Wauwatosa School District shall observe the Student Bill of Rights as an integral part of fulfilling its mission to the students of Wauwatosa. As a student of Wauwatosa School District, I have the right to a challenging, relevant skills base and accompanied by the resources necessary to support my needs. I have the right to a say in my education. 3, I have the right to a clean and safe learning environment. 4, I have the right to learn in a mutually respectful school environment. 5, I have the right to staff members who have high expectations for me. 6, I have the right to an education that includes opportunities for social and emotional development. And 7, I have the right to an honest, accessible, and engaged instructional staff. And all these documents, all these 7 items came directly from the students. All we did was provide them the venue to discuss this. And we should be very proud of the students here because there was very little asking for things like, more tater tots, or longer passing time, or more recess, not sharing lockers, things like that. You may have gotten that comment, but the other students in the room said, that's not something we want on a document like this, and it turned the conversation back towards these items. We should be very proud of them. They were very focused and knew exactly what they wanted in this document. Our next step is to take a look at this document and figure out how to implement it within the district, how do we use it, do we connect it and integrate it into Second Step and to PBIS, do we integrate it into the academic curriculums, for example, social studies, so that it gets a yearly review, so that it actually is a living document. Do we tie it to the code of conduct or the responsibilities for the students so they know they have responsibilities and so does the district at the same time. Then once we figure out how to use it, we'll have to look at staff development, how we'll integrate that in the classroom, and we also took a look at some posters and things to get that out there so it's part of, it's on the space just like our mission statement. And last but not least, thank you, especially to the students who gave their time freely. I think we're very focused on what they had to do. The principals of high schools and middle schools and elementary schools who gave us time to work with the kids during the school day. Eighth grade teachers, Mr. Hedrick and Ms. Duff, who integrated it in their lessons. Mrs. Walzak led the charge at West High School to help us out, even though she wasn't part of the committee. And Student Bill of Rights Committee, Mrs. Wainscott's daughter, she was coerced into helping us develop a few posters as samples. And also Dr. Erdl at the Ehrenberger, introduced by Kowski, helped us get this all organized so we had a good representative population. And for clarification, point four, we did change that because we had mutually respectable, and was pointed out as we shared it with different teachers and parents, that respectable means it's a little more, it's different than respectful. Respectable means holding in high regard. We wanted a respectful environment, a respectable environment. So we changed that. And we also thought it would be better to change the elementary version as well, so that it read the right to learn in an environment that was respects me and teaches me to respect others. Questions?
Board members, any questions or comments?
Looking at the action steps from the long range plan, specifically number six, that engage comprehensive and research based anti-bullying program at all levels. What kind of discussions have you had about that, and how do you see that in your next steps? Bullying in particular, and the fact that we talked about, you know, getting a research based anti-bullying program.
That came up as part of it, but it wasn't really our charge to figure out how to implement that. It came up in discussions of what the kids did not want. And then what we did was we had discussions with, which pertained to Second Step and PBIS, as making sure that there's more emphasis on anti-bullying. So this document was more to create what they wanted from us, not to discuss the, you know, the bullying curriculum or what we're going to go with that. But that was brought up.
And one of the things that shows they completed the step is integrating a curriculum, a research-based curriculum for anti-bullying. And do you see yourself going in that direction?
Well, right, yeah,
the PBIS and Second Step.
Right.
I think that was really a charge of the school committee.
No, I think that would be in relationship more towards student services and the counseling model. And PBIS and how we're operating, whether Second Step continues or not, we continue with that program a little bit, something different. But the charge of this group was not necessarily look at a bullying curriculum.
Well, that's why we talked with Ms. Kwiatkowski about how we could take this and integrate it together into the student services so that they can work together. So this can be used along with whatever we decide to do.
Correct. And there's currently anti-bullying curriculum. There's been reference to Second Step. There's components of that that is centered around anti-bullying, as well as curriculum delivered at the middle school as well. So it's not that it's not happening. We're always looking at what we're doing, and certainly I think this Bill of Rights will again force us and allow us to look at our current practices around the curriculum we're currently using with students in our schools.
And I guess having been on this committee I did want to point out that it was pretty specific that we wanted a research-based program implemented at every level. Mm-hmm. And that's the, you know, the end result that we're looking for here, or that was being looked for in that committee. Mm-hmm. And I know since then we've had some parents step forward with bullying issues, and I know that we reassured them that we are working specifically on that. So if you wouldn't mind exploring that more.
Sure, I think it's really discussions. That was a big part of the discussion. How would they use this document in order to enforce and implement it, you know, with the students? So part of our committee felt that they could always reflect back. When you're talking about respect, they could say, remember number four of, you know, this is what we're talking about, and then they were going to combine that, especially with the positive behavioral intervention and support program that we're looking at. So I think we have that totally in mind, but it wouldn't be part, you know, it's not like part of this, it wasn't part of our charge.
Okay. I know you have more steps to go. You're going to keep going with this.
I'll be happy to sit on another committee and follow through.
Another committee would be addressing?
I mean, if whatever way to talk about it, you know, I'm happy to. I always share what we've done in other committees, so I always carry over and say, you know, I would be the one who would say, you know, remember we have the Bill of Rights.
And I understand PBIS is part of that, second step, and the Bill of Rights, but I do think it's a time. Not just in our district, but universally, where bullying specifically needs a good look.
Mrs. Wilson and Mr. Rick.
Could we please state what PBIS is for someone who may be looking in and does not know what that is? So could we have that cleared?
Sure. PBIS stands for Positive Behavior Interventions and Supports. It's a proactive model. It's a universal model where you look at your school-wide practices and suggests that 80% of the students will get their needs met by just some good proactive practices around school climate, school rules, everybody working together to support positive behavior of students and reinforcing and encouraging students, teaching students how they're expected to behave in school.
Would it be appropriate to have that stated, explained somewhere in here so that someone reading it for the first time would understand what it stands for? I think, and I've spoken to this in the past, we use initials and we assume that everyone knows and they don't always know. So, and then the other thing...
Can I respond to that, Mrs. Lord? In this document, I don't think it would be appropriate. Because this is more of a universal document that regardless of whether or not we're implementing PBIS, this is going to be something that will be with us and it will supersede any kind of intervention or program that we might look at. In other words, we want this to last longer. We don't want to be dependent upon anything like a discipline program or an action called a discipline program. Behavior intervention. Behavior support program. So this is a step above.
But I would suggest that we keep in mind that everyone doesn't know that. So when we are talking about it to the public, that we at least make it understood what it stands for. And then help me with this, please. It's a very fine document. The one thing I read a number of times, and I thought, what they would like, but do not we each have responsibility to give that same respect? And I'm sorry I missed that in here, and I wondered if that's something that we should be looking. We need to demonstrate appropriate behavior, and just help me if I missed it somewhere along the line.
No, that was number four, and that was what they asked for. Number four, they wanted the right to learn in a mutually respectful school environment, so they want to be respected, as well as having to respect the adults in the schools.
I see that a great deal today that there is not. It's a great amount of me only, and they're not looking at, I have a responsibility in all aspects, in all situations. And I would like to be sure that that's understood, that the young people, I see that the elementary school, Mrs. Randall spoke of bullying. There's a behavior that I think that we need to be careful with. Each one of us is respectful of the other. And adults, the same as the young child.
Could you be kind enough to send us an electronic copy of the updated version? Because of the help that we have, I don't want to mix up the old and the new. You asked a question in your presentation along the lines of how are we going to use this document and what uses will be applied. Another potential use, and we'll probably have to have some discussion at the board level about whether this would be appropriate, but it just comes to my mind that as board members, we have the opportunity and the responsibility from time to time to be evaluating behaviors of individuals. We have disciplinary proceedings that we get involved in, individuals, including student behaviors. This may become a measuring stick that we keep in mind, that we are looking at when we're considering a specific behavior and evaluating if it meets or does not meet certain expectations that we have in the district. This might be another document that we could refer to in that setting in order to address that issue. So as I said, we probably have some discussion internally about that, but I think that's a very, I'm curious to see if that we could agree internally to utilize that.
I'll admit I wasn't really behind this idea when I first heard about it, but I really like what you put together, because I can imagine some really, really useful conversations between teachers and students at the beginning of the year saying, you know, your fellow students in the district say that you want high expectations, and that we should expect a lot from you, and that's what I want too. And that for each one of these, that, you know, to show the students that they actually want the same things that the teachers want. And I think that's going to be really helpful. One question I have is how are you presenting this to parents? You know, if a parent, you know, views these as real rights, says right on there, and their child isn't doing well, and they take as a particular curriculum problem, and they say, oh, I have a right to a curriculum that works. How is that handled? How will you explain how this is doing things to parents?
What we discussed was having it be just like we do with the code of conduct, and where students have to sign that code of conduct, this would be in there as well for parents to view. And then we would say, you know, we would like to discuss the C, you know, talk to the administrator or the teachers to discuss it further. We didn't get into like enforcement or anything like that. We didn't feel that was our role, but it would go back to the administration and the board as to how these things are enforced. What I liked about it is they weren't only focused on adult interactions with them, they were focused on other student interactions with them, especially when it came to like the right to a clean, safe learning environment. They had high expectations of their peers as well as from adults. So hope I answered your question.
Yeah, but I just think that's something to give some thought to. Yeah. Some people might read this as, you know, my student has a right to this and we need to change something.
I think we kind of just talked about that a little bit before, but it doesn't take away the fact that there's going to be conflict. There's going to be conflict at times about whether or not this is working for my child. I fully expect that parents, when they come in to meet with me or the principals or whoever else, present a concern, but they'll use this as some supporting documentation to say that, here's an example. We have a right to challenge a curriculum. At least we're discussing the same issues, then. It's not off on different avenues. And I look at this and just say, this is awesome. I'm looking forward to those conversations because they are more focused on whether it's our mission statement, our belief statements, or our student rights. It's a common language. It's a common understanding. And I think that will help in those conversations and those decisions as we look and deal with those. Because right now, we don't have that basis from the student perspective.
I think it's going to be really useful. If the teachers use it right with the students, I think they have a chance to get off to, you know, to really good starts at the beginning of the year. That's good. Thanks.
Mr. Meyer?
I have some unanswered questions regarding the idea of rights, and that with the creation of a right or declaration of a right, do we establish a duty on the part of the school district, and do we get ourselves into a situation where we're in breach of the duty and we aren't fulfilling the duty and we are required to provide a remedy? Things such as a right to resources necessary to support my needs. I think those things need to be better defined. The right to have a say in my education. What does that mean? The right to a safe learning environment, and I've been injured because I fell. I need to know what this means when we say these things. There's some things seem pretty harmless and very proactively positive, like the right to learn in a mutually respectable school environment, or respectful, perhaps you meant to say. But some other rights here, I don't know what we're doing with that. There's a lot of good things to it, but I could see how we could have some unanticipated consequences by a vote or an administrative rule that establishes rights without further definition of what it means when we say this.
Well, I was looking at Mr. Channon to see if he can give kind of a legal perspective. My non-legal perspective is the students already have these rights. We're just stating them. But I'll let Dan comment from.
Yeah, I guess I'll give you a brief legal perspective. In terms of students already having a lot of these rights, I guess for the first part of it, obviously students have a constitutional property right under Wisconsin law to their education, and that's really going to be the overarching document where students are going to enforce their right. In terms of things like safety or the quality of our curriculum, safety is going to be enforced ultimately through kind of that general tort liability under law. We're not going to be able to modify that through our policies. We already have that duty to create a reasonably safe environment, and we do that through a number of our policies. So I don't know that this document expands rights that already exist in as much as it puts it in a user-friendly format. I'd comment also on the right to a curriculum that is challenging, relevant, and skills-based. Ultimately, it is the Board of Education that's making the curriculum and approving curriculum decisions. So, in terms of individual bargaining with students about curriculum, we have a process for approving curriculum. I think what this document does is takes a large number of policies and complicated rights and puts them in a format that's user-friendly, but I don't believe that would alter the legal relationship we have with our students, because those almost all of these obligations appear somewhere else in our either law or policies.
Well, for example, in right three, these are what interesting cases are made of. Of course, the right to a safe learning environment, you use the word reasonably safe, or the phrase reasonably safe. Need we say reasonably safe? I mean, what are we doing? Are we?
I would say students have a right to a safe learning environment as defined by OSHA requirements and all of the vast number of safety statutes that we have to apply for, and that would be the definition of safe. Obviously, we don't want to be defending a tort lawsuit here, but I mean, that's, you know, I use the word reasonable because I had done practice, but I don't think this creates a higher right than already exists in our policies or that exists in terms of our obligations towards our students, but the OSHA standards and other safety rules that we comply with aren't exactly user-friendly for students.
Anything further, Mr. Mayor?
No.
And just a quick follow-up both to Mrs. Weber's comments and Mr. Myers. In the action plan, we talked about calling it the Bill of Rights and Responsibilities. And I know in other districts, I've been looking around researching some of that, and they call it the Bill of Rights and Responsibilities. Is that anything you talked about or might want to talk about based on some of the comments?
I don't recall. No, we didn't get into the responsibilities. We thought that was in charge of like the code of conduct. We have already set our standards for their responsibilities as students.
Okay.
If you add this to it, you could call it that.
Mm-hmm.
I think that our charge was to get students' input on what they wanted in their educational experience here in the Wauwatosa School District.
Mm-hmm.
Anything further, board members? Is there any community comment on this agenda item?
Hi, my name is B. Lex. I live at 63 West Well Street. And I think it's wonderful for students to have rights, but how much of the responsibility effect is being presented to them along with these rights that they are expressing such great interest in. Nothing, you know, no rights go without responsibility, obviously, and I don't know, this is my first time at a school board meeting, so I'm totally unfamiliar with all your proceedings, unfortunately, and I had a bunch of stuff that I want to discuss, but I guess I'm out of the running here. But I question that. I think maybe some, I think Mr. Myers' thing about, you know, making things clear, more clearly stated, such as defined, I guess, might be the right word. A right to say in my education, I don't know what that means either. There's so many loopholes here. And I don't like to think that the students are dictating what's going to happen at school. That is not their right to determine that. I mean, we all have rights and responsibilities regardless of who we are. And I question the idea of giving them too much say in thinking that they have all the rights and that there are no responsibilities go with it. Okay?
Thank you for your comments.
You're welcome.
Ben, do you see this coming back for us in a similar or different format at some point in the future?
Yes, I'd like to bring that for a board of
approval. All right, I'll look forward to that.
Just a general question. Do you envision this as becoming a board policy? Do you envision it as being something separate from that?
Nothing in policy, just having the board approve the concept of it. So approving it in concept, and administratively we would use it throughout the district.
Thank you very much for your report, Amy Morton.
Thank you.
Dr. Earle, I believe, has a couple of comments. Before we get to that, I would like to just address Ms. Lux briefly. I know you said you were not familiar with our procedures and had some comments to make. If there's an agenda item which has passed, but you'd still like board members to have your comments, please feel free to submit those in writing, and we'd be more than happy to bring forward. If you just want to do it to one person, you could direct them to the superintendent who will disseminate it. Otherwise, all of our addresses are on the district website.
Question, when does this come out? How far ahead of the school board meeting does an agenda come out that I can have?
Generally, it's online at the latest Thursday. Thursday before the Monday board meeting.
Thursday before Monday.
Dr. Erwin, would you have a brief report?
Just a comment again, just to remind everybody that we are going to be pursuing the legislative advocacy committee and reconvening that again and start working on the property tax levy, school tax levy credit piece that we discussed earlier. And then also, I just wanted to share that the Tulsa Athletic Fields golf outing is being held July 13th. There's information on the district webpage. It's the annual golf outing that raises money for upkeep and development of our athletic facilities. And foursomes are welcome to sign up and also sponsorships for holes as well. So, again, July 13th.
There is now one last opportunity for public comment on non-agenda items. If anyone has a comment on an item which was not on tonight's agenda, please give us the microphone at this time. Seeing none, following our regular meeting, the school board will adjourn into executive session for two purposes. First, to discuss the status of negotiations with the Wauwatosa Educational Support Association and the Wauwatosa Educational Support Professionals. The statutory exemption to Wisconsin open meetings law is contained in section 19.85, sub 1, sub E. The second purpose is to consider the retirement of a teacher, including consideration of financial, medical, social, or personal history or disciplinary data, which if discussed in public would be likely to have a substantial adverse effect on the reputation of any person referred to in such history or data. The statutory exemption to Wisconsin open meetings law is contained in section 19.85, sub 1, sub F. Following the closed session discussion relating to the retirement of the teacher, the board will reconvene into open session to take action on the proposed retirement. Is there a motion to adjourn into executive session?
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Ray. Is there a second?
Yes.
Thank you, Mrs. Randall. Mrs. Blanton, would you call the roll?
Mr. Cromer?
Yes.
Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Mrs. Milfeld?
Yes.
Mrs. Randall?
Yes.
Mr. Ray?
Yes.
Mrs. Weber?
Yes.
Mrs. Steve?
Yes. We will now adjourn and we'll reconvene at 9:00.
Complete our executive session portion of the meeting and then immediately reconvene in open session in order to take action on the retirement issue that was discussed during the closed session. Thank you, Mrs. Weber.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Neufeld. We'll do a roll call vote. Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Mrs. Neufeld?
Yes.
Mrs. Randall?
Yes.
Mrs. Weber?
Yes.
Mr. Conner?
Yes.
Mr. Ray, yes. All right, so now we're back in open session. And, take it long. Yes. Okay. Earlier this evening, we were participating in an executive session portion of our meeting. During that time, Mrs. Fee left the meeting. She left before we discussed the item, which brings us back into this open session portion of the meeting, and so she did not participate in that discussion in any way. At this point in time, do we have a motion with respect to the retirement issue that was discussed?
I move to accept the retirement and release.
Right. And that is based on documentation that was provided to the board for review during our executive session?
Yes.
All right. Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Croner. Any discussion with respect to that issue? If not, Dr. Erdl, would you mind doing a roll call vote with respect to the motion that is on the table?
Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Ms. Neufeld?
Yes.
Mr. Rangel?
Yes.
Mr. Croner?
Yes.
Mr. Ray?
Yes.
Ms. Weber?
Yes.
And I believe that then concludes our business for this evening. So if we could have a motion to adjourn, that would be appropriate.
I move to adjourn.
Thank you, Mrs. Weber and Mr. Meyer. And we'll do a roll call vote for adjournment. Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Mrs. Milfeld?
Yes.
Mrs. Randall?
Yes.
Mrs. Weber?
Yes.
Mr. Croner?
Yes.
And myself, yes. So we are adjourned at 10:55.